to give something relevant in this conference. So in the National Széchenyi Library is our national library in Budapest. I'm working in the research department, and we are doing research on the library system and on, in particular, on the public libraries. So this is much more my research field, and I have less focus on lifelong learning and on information literacy. That's why I chose this topic. After we have heard from Branislav's wonderful presentation that who we are, the next presentation will be what we should do, or what is our role in the society as an educators. And I do hope that I can give you some new aspects about it. And I experienced that there are two big challenges in the society. The one is multiculturalism, and the other is the digitalization of the society. And I do think that the public libraries has a very important role in this context. Before I tell you anything about it, I would like to show you a script on a Norwegian libraries, public libraries, Vol. I guess you don't speak too well Norwegian. That's why I wrote it here in English as well. It is about reading is thinking with someone else's head instead of one's own. So this is about reading, and this is something that this public library suggests, that this is our role. And why is it interesting, this public library? They are in a very multicultural place in Oslo. There are lots of such places. It was in the suburb when around 60% of the library's visitors have a non-Western background. So they are not Hungarians, they are not Czechs, not Slovaks, not Polish, and not from this Europe. They are from somewhere else, from third countries or from other countries, who has very, very different views, very different cultural backgrounds. So first of all, I would like to tell you some things what is generally perceived as the public library's role. One is the information that we are giving information to people, and we are giving equal access to information to everyone. We are also promoting a culture. We give the possibility of formal and non-formal education. And the public library is also a place when people can, what people can use as a place for recreation, a place where they can have fun, and where they, when they can just hang around, and which can make their life easier or life better. And generally, what we can see in the public libraries space is that there are an increasingly blurring borders between the content what we are giving to people. So the public libraries and also the library sector is giving people very different content. We can also serve people with images, with videos, with any type of content, especially in the digital space. The other thing in which we have blurring borders is blurring borders between the institutions. So it's very difficult to say who we are in the space, who we are, the public librarians, and what is the role of the museum people, the museologists. Museologists also. How many museologists are there in the room? Nobody? Okay, I can say what I want. So the museologists are doing the same what we are doing. So they would like to give people space for hanging around, space for recreation, for education, for culture, and giving information about lots of different things. So there's a blurring borders between the different institutions and the institutions with different functions, and that's why it is a very difficult thing finding who we are in this society, which is increasingly shaped by multiculturalism and by digitization. Recently there was a survey which was conducted in parallel in Finland, in Norway, and in the Netherlands. And in this survey, people were asked on what way could they profit from the public library. And you can see that there are very interesting things listed on this in this survey. For example, finding jobs, work tasks, job skills, educational opportunities. These are quite obvious, but if we are seeing childcare, or health, or travel and vacation, these are all very difficult. These are very, very difficult to fit in the traditional roles of public libraries: the information, culture, education, recreation. And if you see this this chart, you can see that, for example, in Finland, almost 30% of the respondents said that they could profit from the public library as an institution when they could put their children, and which helped them in childcare. And certainly fun in reading got very high marks in every country. So that's why it's a question what we should do in the next in the near future. And I'd like to present to you now these two major trends that are shaping the environment around us. First is multiculturalism. It's traditionally about the influx of people from third countries, or people with a non-Western background, or who are culturally different from us. But this phenomenon is very relevant in the Western countries. It is even relevant in our countries, but it is even more relevant in our countries if we are speaking about the diversity of people and the people with different background. And we can say that a lot of people, lots of different people are living around us, and the public library should promote to how to understand each other. The other main trend is digitalization, the growth of knowledge society. Branislav told a lot about the growth of knowledge society. What is my first remark around it is that the digitalization of the society, and in particular, which is more relevant for us, the digitization of content in the public libraries, in museums, and in other public institutions, it generates a lot of new expectations from the users, and we can never catch them. So they are always one step further on, and we always try to be relevant, and they are always expecting more and more. So let's see first the multiculturalism. There's a multicultural library manifesto from IFLA, and it is just the missions of multicultural library services, what I listed here. And it is about encouraging linguistic diversity, promoting awareness of the positive value of cultural diversity. And everything what is listed here is about being aware of that we are different, and it is generally about people with different language, with linguistic, cultural, religious, etc. background are living together, and public libraries should serve them equally with their possibilities. In a Central European context, we can much more use GANS approach for multiculturalism, and he said that there are especially in urban spaces, there are five groups that can be regarded as different cultural groups, and only one of these groups are about the immigrants or those people who are coming from other countries in the hope of a better life. The first group are the cosmopolitans, and if you can see, you are also, many of you are university teachers and researcher professionals. We are those people who have different cultural representations, and it is our identity is not defined primarily about the locality in which we happen to live. So we're living in a certain country, but we are, or in a certain context, but our identities are not primarily defined by these environments. The next group are young unmarried people who has transitory cultural belongings. They have a new they have to find their belongings in their lives. And Gans said that the young people are still seeking for finding these identities and these belongings. The next group are, which are traditionally regarded as multicultural groups, are ethnic villagers, immigrants from third countries, or Romani people. In Hungary we have a lot of Romani people, and they have different cultural backgrounds, but this cultural, they are not as far from us as those people who are coming from other countries. So the gypsies are ours, so they are very heavily part of our society for hundreds of years. And the next two groups are the deprived people, the unemployed social clients who are threatened by social exclusion, and also those people who have also transitory values, who are just dropped out from the society because they are representing the industrial society and not the new, they can't uptake the new trends and can't find their ways in the new knowledge society's environment. In the multicultural societies, there is a bunch of research around it. What should be the public library's role in this, in facing with multicultural societies? And my favorite theory is from Ragnar Audunsen, a Norwegian professor, who said that the libraries should function as low-intensive meeting places. And he says there is a dichotomy between the low and the high-intensive meeting places. And the high-intensive places are those places where people are going with the same interests and with the same background, and they have the same values. So, for example, if we are members of a religious community, we have the same values which we can face with the people, and we don't face with other people. Those people are too far from us. Or if we are football fans, we can be sure that around us in the stadium, people also love football, and it's a nice place to go, because it is all the meetings are happening quite intensively. And Audunsen says that we need also so-called low-intensive meeting places. The low-intensive meeting places are which are open, there is a very low threshold. Do you know what is threshold? It is the threshold when you are coming back in the door, the threshold is down. And you, if you have a low threshold, you can step in easily. And these are the low intensive meeting places where you can step in easily. And he says that the public library should be low intensive meeting places where people with different values and with different background can come in very easily. The next thing is about digitization or digitalization. There's this is the next trend that I would like to describe a little bit more. I've heard about, I don't know if it is true or not, I just heard it in a conference that digitalization, it is the digitalization of the society. And digitization, and if you are digitizing content, is it true, Bronislav? Yeah, you are very good at terminology, thank you very much. Digitalization of the society is about the growth of the knowledge society and how the libraries, museums, archives can contribute to the digitalized society. It, digitization, when we are where we are digitizing content and we are making all or making available all the documents and all the content we have in a digital format. But it's there is a very high risk with this digitization of content because we are moving toward a single text. Everybody's all the institutions are giving access to all the content that they have, and from the user's point of view, they can see only a lot of content on the internet, and they can facing with huge amount of content, and they don't care about who made it available. This is the risk for our institutions, and what we have to do in the public libraries and in the public sector to remain relevant in this context when all these content are made available online. There are other important trends about digitization. It is a growing trend about the user-generated content. There's a huge amount of content that are made available by the libraries, but the user-generated content is even more and more important. Institutions try to capture the community information, all the information that are generated by the community. We have aggregators who are aggregating all the content which were made available by the different institutions and giving access, giving single access point to it. The best example for it is Europeana, which is a European-wide aggregator of content. And the last remark about it is the use, the reuse of the digitized content that is quite important. And what is even more important is the reuse of content. So the traditional way of using a content is that I go in there and I consume it. But the new trend is I find something and I reuse it. I make a service from it. I make something new from it and create a new service or create new content from all that is already digitized. Okay, then let's see what does it mean for us in the field of education or in the field of seamless learning. And we had a wonderful work with Europeana people in which we made recommendations for institutions and for European governments about how they should use content, Europeana content and digitized content for education. And in this document, we said that the nature of learning is continuously changing, and these are the main points that we found in this context. These points are: learning takes place outside of classroom and formal institutions. Digital learning is becoming more important. There are more and more people who are learning in front of an interface, in front of a computer, and they need visual images, they need moving images, and there is more attention that is given to the competencies like cultural awareness, digital, social, civic competencies, which are about meeting with different values and facing with different cultural etc. backgrounds. And according to these changes with the multicultural society, with the digitalized society, and with the changing nature of education, we have to reinterpret our roles. We have to give access to the single big text, the big digitized text, and develop services. And in these services, what is important to reflect to content, to reflect to each other, and to reflect to each other's reflections, etc., and to reflect many different things. So what is different from the older paradigm is that it is not enough anymore to give access to certain amount of information, because it is one single text. What is a new thing is to develop services in which we have the possibility to reflect to each other. And finally, I would like to show you some examples from all over Europe, how different institutions try to work in this environment, and how can they generate these reflections via services. One example is the Europeana. Europeana has just written down their strategy. And in their strategy, they said that the main stakeholders of Europeana services are the end user services. This is one target group, very important target group. They are the data partner services. They are in connection with lots of different institutions, and they also have important partners with the creative industry. They are the reuser services, and what they need. End users, what they want, maybe you can't, it's very, very small. This lady with the glasses, she says, I want any reliable information for my thesis on migration. I'm looking for images from World War I, etc. So they need they need access point to this single text. And they need sounds, images, content. What is a little bit more interesting for us are the reuser services. In this, this European world that I already mentioned to you, we made also recommendations for the tourism industry, the research industry, or the researchers, and the education. And these are those sectors that can use all the content what the public libraries, any other heritage institutions made available on the internet. And what the creatives want? The creatives, they want free content. They want any content that they can reuse, what they can use for making a new service. I will show you some examples about it also later. And it's a very big challenge for us. There's an estimation about how much content of the European cultural heritage is digitized. The estimation is 10%. And what is available on the Europeana is the 12% of this 10%. And what is freely available in this 12% of the 10% is 35%. So it's very few, very, very little. So we have a lot to do in this field from the institution's side. And why it is important, just a small remark, it is because in a digitalized society, heritage institutions can't be financed anymore because they are dealing with culture. The culture is something very good that should be financed. It's over, unfortunately. And they need to generate GDP. They need to generate new services. They need to generate something which is important and which is relevant for the society. So this was the Europeana's example. And the next examples will be concrete services. I guess you know Europeana 1418. Do you know it? It is about it is a Europeana page, and they made special days in where people can give them their personal memories from the First World War, and these memories were digitized. So this is a kind of user-generated content, and this content was made available on the Europeana on different languages. They also published a book book around it. And why it is very important for us, we said that we need to generate reflections to each other in a digitized environment. So this is what they are doing with this First World War. It is a nice opportunity to speak out from ourselves this shocking First World War, and it can be done with the French and Germans can do it together. And it's very important in the history that they can speak together and they can reflect to each other via these kind of services. It's a very nice example. The next one is very much educational, much more relevant in education. It's a settlement Europeana. It is also a Europeana sub-project. It was made by Spanish institutions. And it was settlement is a competition, and secondary school students could write novels or generate any kind of content or write an article about Europeana content. So they could retrieve content from Europeana, and they can start they can imagine something, and they could write it down when they could reflect the content of Europeana. The winner of this settlement Europeana was a balloon trip over Madrid, and it described how Madrid looked in the 16th century. And the students could use the Europeana content, how it looked like. They imagine that they can fly over it and describe it. Anybody could participate in it. The next one is Historiana. It is also about Europeana content, but it is a site which was created by the history teachers of an association of history teachers or something like that in Europe, and they made this this site, and thank you, and this was about reflecting to each other, and they could also say something that we should reflect to conflict and cooperation, and people could discuss around these things. And I do think that we have a lot of things that we should discuss, and we are continuously reflecting to the history, and history is made vivid via this service and this new approach. And this is not about updating what happened in the past. It is about the reflection of the past, continuous reflection of the past, and about other nations. This is one of my favorites, but it is not a Europeana project. It was a Melinda and Bill Gates Foundation financed this project, Biblioteca Iurie Lovța. It was made in Romania. Iurie Lovța is a small settlement with fishermen and with a Russian minority. And the older generation, they are holding the tradition, the oral tradition. They have a lot of memories about former life. And there's a younger generation who can use the technology. And the main purpose of this project was to collect the memories of the old people and they put it on the internet, on a website. And it generated a lot of nice meetings between the old and the young. Because the old people, they could learn that these young people are very kind. They are not like the other young people. And the young people could also understand the older generation, and they could understand each other, and they could learn about each other, and they could form a real community in Jurilovce around the heritage. And finally, something very innovative, it's from the Netherlands. This is the Van Gogh Yourself project. Any museums can join to this project. It is about, there are a lot of different artifacts on the internet about pictures and masterpieces of art. And if you decide, you can make the same setting with your friends, and you can upload your interpretation of the same masterpiece and put it onto the internet. And if you see the one on the on your right hand, it is not just about fun. It is about making the heritage lively and reinterpret this masterpieces. What you can see there is the dying Adonis, and you can see this guy who is also dying with a huge amount of technical tools around him, and you can have a lot of different association with the original masterpiece as well from it. So this was my last example. So my conclusion about the roles of public libraries in the multicultural and digital context is that we have to launch new partnerships, and what is our role is to create cultural bridges between different people, between the young and the older, between the minorities and the majority, and so on. We should also collect the memories as well. We should concentrate on the users, on the user-generated content as well, and if we are concentrating on them, the community will become more active, and they will be able to develop their identity via heritage, and they can continuously reflect the heritage via these services. And what we should never forget, that we are a library, and all these services should be launched and should be based on the library's knowledge base. So it should be based on the content and what we already have. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Good afternoon all to all. First, I would like to thank you to Pavla, for Brano, Branislav and Martele for good cooperation in this project. I hope we will still it in a good condition for further, maybe the next project. It was a very good experience for me to participate, and thank you very much for all. I represent University of Rzeszów. I'm assistant professor at Department of Pedagogy, as it is written. First, I would like to say that I had occasion to work in a prosecutor's office in Lublin for about 5-6 years, doing some works as librarian. It was a professional office, and I was doing everything in this. I think that the number of books was over several thousands, and it was at the time, at the beginning of 2000, when the manager of prosecutor's office bought computer programs, and I was putting to computer programs all these books. It was a new experience for me, and I know what is it that now we use in a library we use by computers program and the possibility to borrow books. First, I would like to introduce a few sentences about the book. What is it? It is a source of knowledge for everyone, regardless of age and the process of learning. An important element is the ability to read and understand text, and the possibility of use this information to better cope with personal problems solving. Now in our times, it's a standard of existence everyone, and it is supporting our life, our problems for every days during work and outside work, I think. Preschool and theory school education is an important period for men, for whom the book influences the shaping of his attitude, character, multilateral development. By reading the text, it is possible that man learns logical thinking, exercises the memory, increases vocabulary, formulates correct sentences, provides clear information that is necessary to proper interpersonal communication, because now we have a lot of conflicts because we don't understand each other, or to say some not proper words. Efficiency and correct use of language is a result of daily reading books and various texts. The beginning of this process is the period of preschool and early school, in which the child begins learning reading and writing skills. The teacher's assistance is essential to achieve this goal, to encourage a pupil to learn reading letters fluently and writing them on paper. It is a fundamental in our times, I think. In addition, the child learns the correct pronunciation of words or constructing of grammatical sentences and explains the proper understanding of the meaning of individual words. But many people should read books to learn new things, make better thinking. They should also strengthen knowledge and strive to mastery during the process of education. In the framework of a school program, it is necessary to organize library classes, I mean in Poland, in order to promote reading among pupils. Teachers, librarians conduct library classes and want to popularize reading books among children and young people. Because in Poland it is very important that each librarian should have a pedagogical education. It is from 2002, and it is obligatory to have special documents that I am a teacher also, so in Poland. So if you don't have it, is possibility to take a postgraduate schools, and it lasts 3 terms, and after this you had a paper and that you are a pedagogy. Our times are characterized by modern technologies. Information and communication technologies are widespread application in the conduct of lessons. Teachers prepare various kinds of multimedia presentation using electronic devices available at the school. The most common ones include interactive whiteboards, computers, multimedia projectors and others. It depends on school, but now it's a tendency that many schools buy a new technologies, new computers, programs, machines, because it is a standard of education in Poland. The article is an attempt to answer the question of how teachers, librarians, perceived modern information and communication technologies and use them to conduct lessons in terms of the ability to use information and education concerning readership and its popularization. It is very important because especially for young generation, it is some need that if teacher conduct any lessons, they want to see some multimedia, they want to see some special effects. It is especially for young generation because it's from the child. The childhood is together with technology, modern technology. Maybe I missed this because I have a lot of slides and maybe I will go to methodology of my research. The subject of exploration or research included in this study is a comparative analysis of the perception and use of ICT, information communication technology, in teaching, in the opinion of Polish teachers, librarians. I thought what to do with my questionnaires or answers, because I gathered over 280. And I thought that it would be good to divide these librarians, teachers, in two groups, one with seniority of work to 20 years, and the next group over 20 years of working inside a library and as a teacher. The aim of the study was to increase knowledge about the perception of the teachers, librarians, information and communication technologies in the field of work in conducting lessons to popularize reading among young people and adults. Barbara Malinowska-Barańska states that in the libraries, I think that in many places of work, not only in libraries, are working together representatives of two or three generations, presenting completely different styles of clothing, ranging through business ethics, management style, attitudes to new technology, modern users, students' requirements. It is also important that many people who work over 20 years, it was a big problem to them, because as for me, everything what concerns new technologies, computers, programs, they should learn by themselves, or maybe by special courses, schooling organized by in the work, inside the work. But as I remember what I was doing in my work, I got some instructions, and I asked about what to do with my program, and the colleague said, you have instructions, so you read instructions and learn by yourself. So it was a very big task for me that I had to learn by myself. And of course it was possible. And these two groups, when the first group which people represent of first group work until 20 years, and it is maybe possible that these people, workers, had some schooling during maybe university classes, maybe during during secondary school or so on. But the second group, over 20 years old, working, it was not possible that they had some classes inside computers. So it is probably that they had to learn by themselves. It is, I had occasion to compare these groups in which way they are doing and they work, schooling work, classes, and using ICT during this program of education. It is important to understand how they perceived the work of teaching in the use of information communication technology as the priorities and what kind of methods of teaching they use. Everything can be valuable information in terms of the teachers' work in younger and older age together with some work experience. It is information about the survey which we cooperate with Pavla and Branislav and Mate, and that the questionnaire which had been presented by Pavla, I translated it into Polish and placed on the platform Google. And I think that 3 weeks in December, 3 or more weeks, I was sending the survey directly to email addresses coming from libraries or educational institutions in order to facilitate the research. Exploration of research started from Rzeszów and province Podkarpackie, but unfortunately after a few days, 10 days, I perceived that I got very, very little answers, and I was disappointed a little and decided to spread the territory of Poland to other provinces, and I sent to Lublin province, Silesia, Lower Silesia, Świętokrzyskie, Łódzkie, Mazowieckie, Opolskie, Pomeranian, West Pomeranian, Great Poland. So I think that it was several thousands of sending, so very, very much. And unfortunately, I got answer, as I said at the beginning, for about 280 only. So it was horrible for me. It is written that at the end of research 285 responses were collected, and after checking all, 11 questionnaires were rejected because of incomplete responses for these questions that have been used to develop this article. Based on a large age range of respondents, I decided to divide them into two groups, what I said before. And until 2 years of work as the first group A and the second group respondents over 20 years of work. I formulated the following research problems on the basis of two groups, other and if so. What are the differences in the perception and use of ICT in teaching in the opinion of Polish teachers' libraries? Librarians, sorry. And maybe I, because I have printed, sorry, I just a second. I have a printed because it will be better to, if you, and this is the answers. Maybe this is better to see that in majority was in majority were women. If you see the group A, 94%, and group B, 98%. Men were very, very few, and in red colors. So it means maybe that in a library dominate women in Poland. So library as a teachers. The next, it is which kind of library they work, and it occurred that over it is very close, 89%, 90% from group A and group B, respondents work in library school, elementary, middle, because in this kind of school it is obligatory to conduct subject concerning library. So of course there are very little from pedagogical libraries, maybe 7% from group A and 6% from group B, and very little from public libraries. Scientific library was one, and professional library was one person. So okay. And the next. Okay, it's better because the next question was how much time respondents work, and full time, as we see, group A 57%, in group B 61%, it's majority. But of course there are some people who work part-time, some one quarter, and some that is one of additional work, because in some elementary school teachers, librarians also conduct normal subjects. For instance, mathematics, geography, and other subjects, because it is too little school to have full-time work inside one school. And the next question was the place, workplace of respondents. And this is the next information that we see, 45 and 46 teacher librarians. So now they are one side that are like teacher, and another side are conducting librarians. Despite this, there are some respondents who are only librarian, but it also means that they can teach, because in Poland we have rules that each librarian must have a special document that can also be teacher from 2002 years. And the next teacher, only teacher, 40% from group A and from group B. And other that is some additional, but it is not very important that I didn't mention because it's not important. According to position of respondents at their work between the two groups didn't show statistical significance, because I counted, and P is the letter P is higher than 0.05. So according to statistical counting. So the next question. It's about conducting lessons. It is now very important because many teachers, especially older, have a problem to prepare a presentation, to prepare a presentation with some sounds, with some videos, with some sounds, because it is a little problem or some difficulties. And for instance, in my department of pedagogy, we have old building, and everything what we want to change, it is under protection of architecture. So it is the problem to modernize and to introduce some modern technologies. So, but some lecturers use by themselves a computer or projectors or some other things. Dorota Grabowska states that it is required to have obligatory teaching qualification among librarians in Poland. So many of them turn to the implementation of curricular times and conduct classroom lessons. Methods and techniques of activation are important in teaching because the teacher does not provide ready-made knowledge to pupils, but create the conditions for self-learning. Edgar Dahl's pyramid of learning shows the effectiveness of different teaching methods. And it is that what we can say to students, it is our lectures, it is only 10% of what they hear. But according to pyramid, it is the best way, 90% of what they do, if they do it by themselves and staging. It is very, very productive. And the next question, it was about the methods of teaching. It was free, face to face, e-learning, mixed teaching and others. Others, it may be minority because it was not mentioned. But the most popular ways of conducting lesson, respondents ticked face to face, 87% from the group A and 90% from B for older teachers. It should be assumed that it is the popular way, especially in the humanities, where everyone supports the transmission of verbal way of communication information. The other way, e-learning, gain very little. I maybe, because I have, maybe it is all, this is very, very significant, face to face, and e-learning, the second, the mixed teaching and others. And firstly, any access to commercial programs that allow prepare a variety of forms of lessons using multimedia, as well as the possibility to put the entire path of education on the internet platform. It's proper protection and conduct during the whole course. According statistical values between the two groups, A and B, didn't show statistical significance. It showed statistical because P was lower than 0.05. I make some, okay. The next question was about methods of teaching, and we have 11 groups, and the answers was very different. Maybe I show in this the first and the the very big answers. You can see teaching face to face to students with ICT, only explanation with presentation. It is very popular among respondents. The second, educational games and toys. The next, group work with ICT. Group work with ICT, discussion, methods of solving problems, problem situation. Based on data from Table 6 among the surveys, librarians dominated the option of teaching face-to-face with the use of information and communication technologies. This is explanation of teacher together with the presentation. It is 74% from the group A and 69% from the group B. Methods of teaching lessons through games received high percentage values in the group A, 60% and 52% in the group B. And discussion placed on the third place with 35% answers from the group A and 45% from the group B. According to the calculation, the result of for this test is different between two groups, what gives the statistical significance at the level of P is lower than 0.005. Okay. I have 1-2 minutes. It is very, very difficult to say about everything. Maybe in short, that is another, the use of electronic devices in teaching. And the first is lecturer's computer. So I am conducting lessons with my own computer. So the first place. The second, interactive whiteboards. And it is very important in Polish area. So the third place, students' computer, and maybe that they can do some presentations what student prepare at home or something else. The next. It is not statistical significant in this because P was higher than 0.005. And the names of electronic tools, it is very big variety, and maybe it is that the first one is electronic presentation among respondents. The second maybe very similar training videos, some cinema, educational games and educational software that students use during classes. Of course, it is not important according to statistical, so P was key square on the basis of key square P was higher than 0.005. Of course, the next. I will finish with some conclusion because the next question was very, very, very big and it is difficult to say very short. So maybe conclusion. This is conclusion. Information and communication technologies are deeply present in the education system for last several years and even more. The access to the use of books, magazines, scientific journals increasingly is possible by internet websites. It is one reason to spread e-books all over the world because everyone has an access to them. According to the research, about 90% of the respondents were teacher librarians who worked in school libraries placed in primary schools. According to the calculation, differentiations between the two groups was at the level of statistical significance in terms of employment in libraries, full-time, part-time, and in the area of methods of teaching. However, in other studies, in which way one can conduct classes as well as the use of electronic tools and equipment, or in areas of discomfort working and how to improve classes it with the use of ICT, all these didn't show any differentiation between the two groups at the level of statistical significance. It should be noted that both older and younger seniority are able to use ICT. In their work, they prepare and develop new training programs in accordance with the requirements in the country and abroad. They are prepared for further changes and at the same time ready to expand knowledge through continuous learning in organized courses and training, as well through self-education at home. Of course, it is important to mention that the test results should be treated as an outline of what is actually in the reality, taking the fact that the author sent a few thousand queries with a request to fill the questionnaire and got answers from less than a few percent of respondents. Despite it, it is also worth considering on the covering the local research directly in the educational institution, and certainly the test results will reflect what is in location. It is worth noting that the computer programs and their continuous updates extort the same equal education for all users without regard to age and seniority. It is important to reinforce the technological education among the young generation should be better adapt to their needs. Thank you very much. It was...
Thank you. For the newcomers, you've heard my name is Pavla Kovářová and I'm from the Division of Information Studies and Librarianship here at the Masaryk University, and I want to speak about the same research as Zbigniew before me, but I will focus on the Czech Republic, and I want to compare all countries in the Visegrad 4 to show differences between these countries, because we can see that they are quite similar. They have quite similar history and conditions now, but there are also some very significant differences between the countries in information literacy education. The goal of my presentation is to describe the current practice of Czech libraries in information literacy lessons, to explore educational interests and educational needs, what is not always the same thing, and compare the results between countries. This research was prepared not only because it's connected with my research interest, but also because of this conference, and I want to show you how we prepared the program of the whole conference according to results of this research. First of all, I want to say why I think that information literacy is necessary for librarians. I think that librarians need these competences to do their work, but I see also the growing number of lessons and students in the lessons in libraries, not only in academic libraries, but because we still hear more about lifelong learning. It's also part of the public libraries, and in the Czech Library Act we have between the library services for the basic libraries, also doing lessons for the public. The numbers of Czech lessons in libraries are growing. When we look to the statistics of Ministry of Culture, we see not as high numbers as you can see here in the university library in Washington State University, but we see the growing numbers too in the Czech libraries, public libraries mostly. We can see also changes in that what can we see as information literacy. Information literacy is something what we can found till 1970s in literature, but the content what is under this term is changing, and I think that the very big change is influenced by the spread of the internet, and now we have not so big problem to access information as before, and we need not so much lessons and education in the competencies of searching information, but we need to focus on information evaluation and information use or reuse, as Mate told us. Information literacy is connected with critical thinking, and the critical thinking is something what has really strong and good impact on the whole society, as you can see here on the picture, and the competences which are necessary for this approach to critical thinking are defined by the Media and Information Literacy Standard, which was signed, which was adopted by UNESCO in 2012, and they are also seen in the framework of for information literacy for higher education, which was adopted by Association of College and Research Libraries in 2015. So we can see that the changes are quite new, and it's question whether the libraries also in the Visegrad can change or could change now the topics in the lessons, or it can last a long time to change their approach to the content of information literacy lessons. The standards accent not only the topics of lessons, but also the ways of teaching, teaching methods, because for critical thinking we need to change the competencies and skills that are taught. It is not possible to use every time the same right method to work with information. That is not critical thinking. We need to use different methods according to actual need of the concrete person, and work in the concrete situation. So we have to know the alternatives of approaches to information, not only in access but also in evaluation of or creating the new information. When we think about teaching methods, we also have to think about people who are taught and the students who are often in lessons of information literacy in libraries are young, and we can see that they prefer different approaches to the learning and teaching. They like active learning, they like a lot of visualization, linking the learned information with their own personal practical life. They can use internet browsers. We cannot we cannot teach them a lot of about basics of searching, but it is necessary to focus on information analysis and interpretation, and that is the problem which is also accented in the new standards of information literacy. When we are doing lessons, it's not only about teaching and about the content of lessons. We need to speak with different stakeholders to have the possibility to teach or to have lessons, because our library management or founder have to give us resources for the lessons. We often have teachers or schools as partners who give us children or students to teach, and all of them have to think that the library can bring them something important, something what help students to work with information. Also, we have to speak with students, because the lessons in the libraries are often not compulsory, and we need students to come or no lessons can take place. And when we speak with other librarians about our lessons, we can share the good practice and not to invent the wheel still again, because it's wasting of resources, our time, our thinking, our reading, and so on. So that was my thesis. And what about practice in the libraries? As Zbigniew said, we used an online questionnaire, which was in local languages, sent through online communities or emails in December 2015. And we have very different numbers from each countries, and the Poland was the best country for this research. From Hungary and Slovak, we have 10 times less questions than from Polish. The responses are from various libraries. They are not only academic libraries or public libraries, they are all libraries. But I think that it can be found also some differences between the library types, but it was not the goal of this presentation or my paper. The questionnaire was divided into five parts. It was about ways of teaching, content, and also about organization before and after the lessons, and also some demographic questions. For me, it was interesting who were respondents of these questionnaires. Because in literature we can see that lessons are often connected with reference librarians. But in Czech Republic, Hungary and Slovakia, we can see that teaching is often connected with executive. Not reference or other librarians, but someone from library management. When we compare the characteristics of teaching librarians, the Czech teaching librarians are the youngest with the shortest experience in teaching, but with the most hours per week dedicated to education compared to other countries. So I think even these are interesting results, but more interesting results are in other parts of the questionnaire. When we focus on lessons content, there are many similarities, but also some differences. For example, from Slovak respondents, I have answer that they include in their lesson search strategies and using various information sources. In evaluation, Czech Republic and Slovakia are significantly more focused on evaluation than Poland and Hungary. And in creation, Czech Republic is really strongly focused on standardization and topics connected with this. Then I try to look on the numbers of lessons in each component of media and information literacy metrics, which means access, evaluation and creation. And I wanted to find how many topics in each component are taught, are in the lessons. So how many diversified are the lessons in the countries. I found that the Czech Republic and Hungary are the mostly focusing on the access, and there are the smallest number of lessons which are from the creation component. This distribution was found in each country, but in the Hungary it was the strongest, and Slovakia was the only country where more topics from evaluation component than from access component. Slovakia was also specific when I made a factor analysis because there was the strongest one of the founded factor which was composite of the topics from the creation component. The strongest factor was searching and using criteria for evaluation of information and sources, what can be labeled as traditional information literacy. The last factor which was found was information safety and ethics, and this factor was the strongest in the Czech Republic. Here is only example about educational interest in the media and information literacy, but the results are were very diversified, and there was no very strongly felt topic who respondents wanted to hear about. So this is only example, and the topics were not often taught in practice now, so they are not known good for librarians. For me there was interesting results, application of ethics, ethical standards in the creation of new knowledge. That was one of the topics who wanted Czech respondents to hear more. We have heard about teaching methods in Poland. Here you can compare the countries. We can see that all countries use frontal teaching with ICT, discussion, practical, individual week work with ICT, and group work with ICT. So you can see that there is a strong strong influence of information technology to teaching. Interesting is Poland here because they do not use often practical individual work of students with information technologies. They more they use computers more for teachers. But they use quite often didactic games and role playing, which were the last, the least often used methods in the Czech Republic. So here are the differences between countries. Ask about technologies which are used. We didn't know that so many technologies are used in teaching methods, as you saw in the previous slide. But also here you can see some traditional using of information technology, computer for lecture, electronic presentation, and some computers for students. Again, you can see that Poland is quite different. Hungary have different has different results in using educational videos, which are not so often, but documents in clouds are really more use compared with other countries. Social networks are not used often, despite they are so popular, so it's also interesting result for me. Because educational interests in teaching methods were mostly connected with information technologies. I have here these two graphs to compare them. You can see that only one and not so often answer was presentation skills that respondents wanted to hear more about. But the most often topics are graphics, educational videos, open educational resources, and these types of technologies. Not so much about ways of teaching, but about using technologies in teaching. As I said in the beginning of my presentation, I think that it is necessary to communicate about information literacy lessons. Respondents said that they have good material conditions from the management, but they have quite little time for lessons and also for their further education. Lessons are often assigned from school or from library management. The topic of lesson is not often decision of a librarian, but it was assigned by other people. Only in Poland is quite often educational need analysis, which was about 20% in other countries. The most often evaluation that was really interesting for me is that in all countries they evaluate, librarians evaluate their lessons according to their feeling after the lesson. So they do not use any research method, but they use their feelings. But in the Czech Republic and in the Poland are quite often questionnaires. When sharing information and experience from the lessons, librarians used mostly speaking with their colleagues and friends, but 11% of librarians do not share their experience with anyone. And educational interests, again, in this topic, Czech librarians want to know more about methodology of preparing lessons and also about questionnaires. Also they use them compared to other countries more. Czech respondents are not so interested in educational needs, which was the most often answer in all other countries. Strong interest was seen in using information literacy standards. I think that you can hear about this topic also today. Librarians are not interested in information literacy advocacy. I'm not sure about the reason of this, but they don't show the interest. What they wanted in Slovakia, they wanted to know how to present their work to the wider audience by article or by presentation at the conference. In Hungary and Poland, they want to know more about other research methods than questionnaires. Questionnaires was other answer. To conclude, I promised to connect results of the questionnaire with the conference program. You can remember that interests in media and information literacy were very diversified. So we looked at the practice in these and we saw the weaker practice in evaluation and creation components. So we have a media literacy panel in this conference and conception of information literacy education. Because of preferring of frontal teaching and not different method according to target group of the lesson. We have a methodology of teaching as the second panel in this conference. And because respondents wanted to hear more about using different technologies to teach, we have our technological panel in the program. Evaluation of lessons by feeling of lecturer is for me a very strong reason why to have a research panel in conference. And the last topic of the panel's information literacy advocacy, it was not the interest for education of respondents, but we saw that they have a weak position to management in time, in possibilities of further education, and that they teach not what they think or what they knew that students have to know, but what the school or partners wants. So I think that information literacy advocacy is also a very important topic for them. So this was my conclusion. Thank you for your attention. And if you have any question, you can ask me now, or I will be here during the whole conference. So you can meet me in the coffee break.